Welcome to our Research Like a Pro with DNA question and answer series on how to use AI in creating a Leeds chart. So this question comes about when we are trying to do a Leeds cluster chart and wondering, can we use this wonderful new tool of artificial intelligence to help us? So a little background on the Leeds method. If you're not familiar with it or you haven't tried it yet, it was developed by Dana Leeds in 2018. And it recommends we use our DNA matches between 90 centiMorgans and 40 centiMorgans with the test taker to separate into four grandparent groups. This is the ideal case, and sometimes we don't actually get the four groups, and there can be a lot of reasons for that. Dana has got a great tutorial at her website, and she also has a YouTube channel where you can see a lot of her videos demonstrating how to do the Leeds method and analyzing one. But today we're going to show how I used AI to help me. So let me introduce just a little mini case study and explain what I was trying to do with the DNA. And that was looking for DNA matches in a Weatherford cluster, so a pretty specific group. I had previously done a project on my ancestors, Clemcy Klein and Henderson Weatherford. And was really fortunate to be able to find DNA descendants coming down from all of their children. They had seven children. My test takers are right here, myself and then cousin Gary, cousin Lucretia. And you can see through each one of these independent child lines that I had a pretty good mix of matches. And there were other matches. I just diagrammed the best matches. Now, for the course of my Clemcy Klein project, I then went out and found matches who were connected to her father or a hypothesized father and siblings. And I found matches to prove her Klein parentage, which was really exciting. But I have not tackled Henderson Weatherford's side. And so he's the next brick wall. I need to try to find some DNA matches going back to his, hopefully, some siblings and a father. And so with this good foundation, I am on the hunt now for a Weatherford group. So just to remind you again of my DNA test takers, there's three of us, and I'm particularly interested in Gary's DNA because when I did the Klein project, I found that he had more DNA. Actually, both Gary and I shared more Klein DNA than Lucretia, which was really interesting because she is one generation closer than me, but I still shared more DNA in many cases than she did. So it's one of those random inheritance things that Gary and I just both got more of the Klein DNA. So working off the idea that perhaps he got some more of the Weatherford DNA as well, I decided I wanted to start with his results and primarily use his results. And I'll of course add in mine and Lucretia's because I like to have three of us and showing how we all share DNA with specific matches. But in doing so and using Gary's, I decided I would use just his paternal matches because the Weatherfords are on the paternal line. I didn't need to try to sort out the maternal because ancestry nicely separates it. And you can see that he's got a lot of matches here in paternal, over 52,000. And so when I went to do my Leeds chart, I was going to be looking for two clear sets of grandparent groups on that paternal side. So I wanted to quickly find the matches between 90 centimorgans and 400 centimorgans as recommended. We're trying to get to the second cousin level. So ancestry lets you filter. And so I had already filtered by paternal, and then I used another filter for between 90 and 400 and got the match list started where I wanted to. And then I went through and took a peek at the matches and noticed that I had quite a few matches that were first cousin once removed, twice removed, three times removed. And these were children, grandchildren, great grandchildren of people that were on Gary's level, generational level. And so I wanted to not have those be part of my Leeds chart. So I just took note of who they were, and I would try to eliminate them as I was doing the charting. And sometimes we don't know about these people, but one of the tips that I have for you is that you can go to through lines, and sometimes you can just see really clearly on through lines where these people are. I also had notes. You can see I have some notes here. And from working on these lines quite a bit, I just actually knew some of these matches and had worked with them before. So I was able to identify some of those first cousin once removed. So the very first thing I did was go to AI and get started with creating that initial table. And I did use Claude AI. You might recognize this background for Claude. And I gave it a prompt. I said, today we are creating a Leeds chart for Gary Shultz. I'll be adding screenshots of Gary's DNA matches to get an initial list of his matches between 90 and should be 400 centiMorgans. As I add screenshots, create a table with seven columns. The first column will have the match name. The second will have the number of centiMorgans shared with Gary. The third column should state the proposed relationship. The other four columns will be used later. And so, I had every intention of putting this prompt in there and then adding right away a screenshot of the first group of matches, but I didn't. I hit enter before I could do that. And so it was fine because AI just replied and said, oh, I get it. You want me to do this Leeds chart. And so actually, it was good to do that because then I could see that it had the right idea for what I wanted it to do. And then it said, I'll wait for you to share the match screenshots to begin populating the table. And I love this little hint. Please note, proposed relationships are estimates based on the amount of shared DNA and may not reflect the actual genealogical relationship. So there we go. AI was giving me some hints there. So I proceeded. I first of all did all the screenshots to do the initial table. And because there were quite a few, I probably had to do about four screenshots. I would just put whatever I could get on my screen. And I just did the really easy, just selected them all and then pasted that right into Claude, which worked really well. And it recognized it, the names, put everything in just perfectly. And then I started with the very first match and went to the shared matches and then pasted screenshots of all those shared matches. And very, very fast, AI gave all those matches the color blue. And then I went down to the one that did not have a match, that was not blue, and pasted shared matches with that match. And then AI gave them red. And we continued. It was very interesting because Claude prompted me and said, do you want to continue with the color red with the match DW, for instance? So it recognized where I needed to start with the next match. So I continued and I ended up with a chart that looked like this. And I did ask AI to go ahead and make all the names anonymized by just using initials, which was really handy for the purpose of this little video. And so you can see here that it used blue dots, red dots, hearts, some squares, kind of had just random shapes there that I didn't ask for, but it was fine. So I did notice, though, that I had some first cousin twice removed that had snuck in there. And this PH right here is actually a first cousin once removed, but the ancestry relationship was second cousin just because of a little bit lower centiMorgan range. So I had a lot of overlap, which I was trying to avoid by getting rid of all those first cousins and the removals. So then I would ask it to say, well, take out, well, actually, before I even started the color coding, I had taken out several of the ones I had noted, but in this one, these had snuck in there. So I wasn't really sure how accurate I had been with my grabbing the shared matches because it was a little confusing for me to see where I was in the chart, just the way, that I was interacting with AI. So I decided that I would put this into a Google Sheet and then I would try it again and compare my results and see what would happen. The thing that I noticed was as I was going through this and adding the shared matches, the chat got really long. And towards the end, Claude kept saying, this chat is getting too long. Do you want to start a new chat? And then after a while, I had used up all my time, and I have a pro account, but it still kicked me out after a bit. So to mitigate that, if I did this again, I would perhaps get the initial chart and take that, copy that, and put it into a new chat. Every so often, start a brand new chat to sort of refresh the AI, because each time I did a new chat, it would read all the previous ones, and so it was using up all of its tokens or its brain power on reading through all the previous chats. So I would just have, you know, it'd be better to copy it. And also just to maybe be keeping track on paper of exactly where I was in the charting. But I went ahead and asked AI to create a CSV file for this because I wanted to get it into a spreadsheet and asked it to give me the file and then wanted to know how to get that comma separated value file into Google Sheets. So it gave me some instructions. And the first time that I did it, it didn't come in quite how I wanted. It was all just in one cell. And so then I was wondering if there was a special way I should paste it. And I found in the headings that there was a paste special. And so, you know, then I was able to see, oh, paste values only. So it was really nice whenever you're working with AI, you can ask it to help you in so many different ways. So I ended up with my chart. And when it came over, it had ones in the color column. This was for blue. And before I changed all these, it had, you know, blue, red, green, yellow. And as I found the common ancestral couple, I'd put their name there. But it had a one if they were supposed to be in that column. And so then I went ahead and did all of my color coding. And so my Google Sheet looked just like the one that Claude had given me. Everybody was just exactly the same. It was just now in a format that I could manipulate a little bit more. You know, I could sort by names and, you know, do different things with it. But I still had a lot of overlap. This wasn't really showing me clearly the Weatherford grouping that I wanted. So I decided to try it again. And as I said, it was going so fast, I wasn't sure how accurate it was. And so then I did another attempt. And this time I decided to have Claude help me, but that I would do all the color coding and matching. So I had Claude be my coworker, and I had it set up the initial table. It takes so long in the Leeds method to copy all the names and the centiMorgans and the possible relationships, whereas the AI did it literally in 1 minute. It had my table created. And then I had it again download it as a CSV file and had that all set up in my Google Sheet. And then I went ahead and did the manual color coding using shared matching. And so as I came, you know, as I looked through it and as I saw different relationships, such as the first cousin once removed, I would go ahead and just delete those so I didn't have those skewing my results. So my second pass through doing it myself, you can see they separated really nicely into the two paternal grandparent groups. I had my Shultz Isenhauers and I had my Weatherford Roystons. And this was the group that I really wanted to focus on. These were the ones that I was hoping would find some unique Weatherford matches pointing to the generation above Henderson. And I did find down here at the bottom that this person had a really large tree, over 1,000 people, and they had a Weatherford line I'd never heard of that I was excited about. And I'm hoping that continuing to look at what this person's shared matches and working within all of these DNA matches, that I'll be able to get a little bit closer to my research objective about finding Henderson's family. So this was much better for me to work with and use, and I felt confident in this. And as I was working through the matching on my own, I could add colored dots to ancestry. I could add some notes if I wanted to. So I really like doing the manual part, this part, on my own. So for using AI with the Leeds method, creating the initial table is a huge time saver. And because you're giving it the data, the screenshot, it does a really good job of bringing in all the data accurately. But my tip is to do the color matching yourself, because for one thing, it helps you become familiar with the DNA matches. And that's really important. So you start to learn who these matches are, and then you're in complete control and you can check yourself and see what's going on. So with that, I hope that gave you some fun ideas about how you could use AI in doing a Leeds chart.